Our subject today is the worthiness of Christ. More specifically, the response of saints on earth to the revealed worthiness of the Lamb in heaven. I'd like to begin by quoting the words of Revelation chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. The 24 elders fall down before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, singing, "You are worthy, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Notice the link between worship and worthy. This is the first time in the book of Revelation that we read about worship. What is worship? It is worth-ship. There are two big ideas that are brought together with this word. Primarily, our response to the discovery of the Lord in His fullness, and the commitment with which we respond. That's where we get this awkward to translate phrase, logikos latria, in Romans 12:1, your reasonable service or your service of worship. No one quite knows exactly how to describe it, but the two ideas are clearly linked, that when we worship, the outflow, the overflow of worship should be in service to the Lord. Now, in Revelation 2 and 3, we see seven churches with their struggles on earth. In Revelation 4 to 7, we have seven hymns of praise to the Lord in heaven. Christina Rossetti said, "Heaven is revealed to earth as the homeland of music." So what do these two very disparate scenes have in common? Christ is in the midst. Now these seven hymns are found in chapter 4, verse 8, 4, verses 10 and 11, chapter 5, verses 8 and 9, chapter 5, verses 11 and 12, chapter 5, verses 13 and 14, chapter 7, verses 9 and 10, and chapter 7, verses 11 and 12. The worship begins with the four living creatures, then moves to the 24 elders. Then the living creatures and the elders join together, and then this progresses to the angel throngs, 10,000 times 10,000, and climaxes with the chorus of all creation. In chapter 7, it changes then to a human multitude, an uncountable human multitude, who sing the sixth hymn, and in the seventh hymn, the elders and the angels and the living creatures join together to sing the concluding chorus. Now, as we study these hymns, although there are eight characteristics mentioned through the seven hymns, we see that five of them are essential ascriptions to the Worthy One. Blessing, which is linked with riches once and with thanksgiving once, honor, glory, wisdom and power, which is linked with strength once and with might once. So, what we have here then is every possible qualification for worthiness: blessing, his personal wealth and the generosity with which he shares it; honor, his exalted position due to the esteem in which he is deservedly held; glory, his personal splendor in the unfolding of the perfections of his character; wisdom, his infinite knowledge and its perfect application in every instance; and power, the authority he wields and the absolute right to use it. Now, one of the great themes in the book of Revelation is that there are actually two classes of creatures. There are glory robbers and glory reflectors. And the role of Christ is to transfer us from one category to the other. Fairbairn writes, "Man's lost sense of God, man's lost sense of spiritual loveliness, comes back to us in the presence of Christ. The final and crowning self-revelation of God is seen in the face of the Lord Jesus. As he said, 'He that has seen me has seen the Father.' And Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, "For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Now, the Apostle Paul in the book of Ephesians reveals Christ's plan and how he's going to do this. There are five references to the heavenlies. Now, the heavenlies are not the glory of heaven, as we've considered earlier, but the glory of heaven come down to earth. So let's think about these five references to the heavenlies as Christ's invitation to ascend with him Transfiguration Mountain and behold his glory. So Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14 gives us this paean of praise, a blessing to God for all that he has enriched us with in the Lord Jesus. We read, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ." So, the heavenlies are the place of blessing. In Revelation we read, "Blessing is ascribed to our Lord." Yes, he's the one who deserves all the blessing. He deserves all of God's riches. He is the heir of everything. He's the creator of everything. He's the sustainer of everything. So, of course, he deserves everything. But what has he done? He hasn't simply shared it with us. He's lavished it upon us. He has given us everything he has. And so, sadly, in this little section, many have turned these blessings into a battlefield. But the idea of our choosing is in Christ. In Christ we have been chosen for what purpose? Not to go to heaven or hell. We've been chosen in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame, notice, before him. Before him. This is a common phrase in the early books of our Bible, the idea of being before the Lord. The sacrifices were offered before the Lord, and the menorah shone before the Lord, and the showbread was before the Lord. And the idea is that God wants intimacy. He wants to draw us near to him, but he also wants us to take responsibility. He's called us to be sons in the family business, and he's given us these tremendous privileges as we draw near to him, to represent him, to serve him. And so we who are the recipients of his blessing then become the vehicles of his blessing to those around us. So blessing, that's the first characteristic of living in the heavenlies, of living on Transfiguration Mountain with our blessed Lord. And then secondly, in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, we read, "The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints." Glory is a characteristic of the heavenlies. Glory for him, but also for us. Yes, we read there in verses 22 and 23 that the Lord has called us into this glorious privilege of identification with him and revealing him to others. And our response in verse 17 is, as Paul prays, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. As the apostle would write in 2 Corinthians 3:18, "But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image, from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord." And it goes on to describe our role in reflecting Christ's glory to the world. This great section on how the gospel should not be hid, we should be reflecting it into the world. I recall visiting St. Thomas, the island in the Caribbean, on our 25th wedding anniversary, and I recall the story of Johann Dober and David Nitschmann. These were Moravian missionaries who wanted to take the gospel to the slaves, but were not permitted to simply go in and preach among them, and so they sold themselves into slavery to go and share the gospel with the slaves. And as their ship pulled away from the shore, they called back to their loved ones, "May the Lamb that was slain receive the reward of his suffering." And then number three, in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 6, we discover that the heavenlies are a place of honor. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ, by grace you've been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. It's astounding, isn't it? Honor for him, yes, absolutely. But he has welcomed us into this place of honor and is seating us with him in that glorious place. What should be our response to this? Well, the complementary chapter to this passage in the book of Colossians says, "If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God." That's Colossians 3, 1-3. In other words, act as if you've already left this world behind. This world is not home anymore. Our attraction be in Christ. And when we set our mind on him and are drawn to him, our lives become outposts of heaven here on earth. And that's what they had on Transfiguration Mountain. In God's time machine, these disciples were swept forward to see Christ in his kingdom glory. And we live now in the conscious awareness that Christ is already seated at the right hand of God. Our man is in, and his seat is uncontested. And then we discover in chapter 3, verses 8 to 11, that the heavenlies are a place of wisdom. Paul says that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery which God has revealed beforehand. And this mystery which God has revealed is from the beginning of the ages, hidden in God, creating all things through Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we learn in this little section first about the unsearchable riches of Christ, and then we learn about God creating everything through Christ, and then we read about his purpose being accomplished in Christ. And these three link together in God's purposes. God has provided all the resources, he has provided a plan, and he is working all things according to this purpose to bring everything together in Christ. We have the privilege now of representing him in the world. And the church is called the pillar and ground of the truth. In other words, the truth is the foundation under us, and it's the capital over us. Buy the truth and sell it not. We are representatives of the truth in this world. The devil is a liar from the beginning and spreads his lies, and it's our privilege to counteract that by the presentation of the wisdom of God as revealed through the church. And then finally, in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12, we discover that the heavenlies is a place of power. "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenlies." And so once again, our response should be to put on the armor of God, gird up the loins of our mind, follow him into battle, knowing he always leads us to triumph in Christ. So here we have then the suitable worship, the reasonable worship that flows out from the true worship of Christ. If we understand that these five glorious things that are due him alone, that we have described in these wonderful hymns in heaven, if he's come to share them with us, that the heavenlies are a place of blessing and glory and honor and wisdom and power, what should we do? Well, the first one says we should draw near to Christ. We should become intimates with the Lord Jesus. Secondly, we should take the responsibility of reflecting Christ, shining forth his glory. Thirdly, we should seek after what pleases Christ. We should seek the things above. And fourthly, as purveyors of his wisdom and truth in the world, we should hold up Christ as the answer to every dilemma of the human condition. And finally, we should follow Christ into battle. We should sing the victory song. We should know that he has already conquered. The battle is the Lord's. The victory is ours. And that's why we pray. We link ourselves with him. We don't try to manipulate his will to accomplish ours. Rather, we align our lives in sympathy with his will, and we seek to cooperate with him in his purposes to accomplish, in the end, glory alone for Christ alone. So thank you for this little study. I hope this has been helpful, and pray the Lord's richest blessing on each one of you as you seek his face and as you reflect his glory until we see him at last.